anyone name them for us? Can you name even one? Hildy.
Manhattan?
Ow!
What's the matter?
Somebody hit me with a spitball.
Willie?
I didn't do nothing.
Anything.
I didn't do that either.
Willie, I'd like just one day to go by without you having to learn from that corner.
Yes, ma'am. But why do we have to study New York City? We'll probably never go there.
In case you do. In case you go anywhere outside of Minnesota, you'll have something besides total ignorance to take with you. Now, Hildy. Manhattan is one of the five areas. Can you name the other four?
No, ma'am.
Can anybody? They are Queens, Staten Island, Brooklyn, and the Bronx. Now, they and Manhattan share a common designation, such as town, city, county, state. Can anyone tell me what that designation is? Willie, can you tell me?
I don't think so.
They're called boroughs.
Really?
Really.
I thought boroughs were some kind of a donkey. Honest, that's what I heard.
That's a different spelling. Now, I'm referring to borough as in B-O-R-O-U-G-H. You're talking about simply borough. B-U-R-R-O. Willie Olson, in the corner.
I did it.
Now, though it's not complete...
If any of you have ever watched Little House on the Prairie, this scene probably looks very familiar. But this scene should also be familiar to anyone who has set foot in a classroom. A new teacher struggling to instruct students effectively is not an isolated occurrence. Some learn quickly, yet others require time. But as similar as these aspects are to the modern classroom, there have been major changes in education since the 1800s. Simple things, like having one room for a whole town of students, using chalkboards for instruction, and mixing different ages in one classroom. But to fully understand the development of education, we should go farther back and take a glimpse at how education has changed and where it is now. When settlers first came to this country, education was heavily tied to religious beliefs. Growth and development of education was still pursued in a similar fashion to how their English counterparts had. This new freedom, however, to change the system, pushed the colonists to establish an educational system of their very own. Moving forward to 1636, Harvard College was founded in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Only 4 years later, Henry Dunster became president of Harvard College. The president taught all courses himself at this time. To jumpstart Harvard's attendance, the Massachusetts law of 1647 required that towns with at least 100 families would have a schoolmaster and a Latin grammar schoolmaster to prepare students to attend Harvard. A century later, the education world was on the verge of a major change when Benjamin Franklin created the American Philosophical Society in 1743. This was groundbreaking due to the fact the ideals clashed with the religious education that was firmly established in the years preceding. The goal of the society was to make advances on humanities and the sciences, and it attracted the superstars of our past, such as George Washington. Thomas Jefferson. John Adams. James Madison. And Thomas Paine. From this, Thomas Jefferson suggested the two-track system, one track for the learned and one track for the laboring.
Worker. Soldier. Worker.
This clip from the movie Ants is somewhat similar to how the two-track system works. Educational advancement depended largely on class. Therefore, scholarship made it hard for the blue-collar class to advance. This system caused a large divide in the education of different classes within the U.S. After the Bill of Rights is passed in 1791, it is implied that education will be a function under the state rather than the national government. Then the 1800s bring about many significant changes to the educational world, such as the blackboard was invented by James Pillins. This new technology was one of the first influential tools to be used in the classroom. The following clip shows just how advantageous technology could be in the classroom.
Ma'am, how's he ever going to get all those numbers off again?
Silence! There will be silence in this classroom. Willie, Laura has asked a question. Will you please demonstrate the answer?
Mary, look! It's clean as a whistle.
The Connecticut Asylum at Hartford for the Instruction of Deaf and Dumb Persons opened, co-founded by Thomas Hopkins Gallaudet and Laurent Clerc. This was the first permanent school for the deaf in the U.S., and later the first college opened for deaf students called Gallaudet University.
When I saw Helen Keller first, she was 6 years and 8 months old. She had been blind and deaf and mute since her 19th month as the result of an illness. She had no way of communicating with those around her except a few imitative signs that she had made for herself. A push meant go and a pull meant come and so on. She had observed that we did not use the hands when we were talking to each other. And I let her see by putting her hand on my face how we talked with our mouths. She felt the vibration of the spoken word. Instantly, she spelled, I want to talk with my mouth. That seemed impossible. But after experimenting for a time, we found that placing her hand in this position.
Boston English High School was the first high school ever built. In these days, that seemed far-fetched, since high schools are such a commonplace within our communities today. Horace Mann was elected secretary of the new Massachusetts State Board of Education and worked to raise funding and increase quality in the training of teachers. Elizabeth Blackwell was the first woman to graduate from medical school, which makes history for women and the medical world. The first kindergarten was founded by Marguerite Schurz in Watertown, Wisconsin. She was followed by Elizabeth Palmer Peabody, who opened the first formal kindergarten in Boston. The Department of Education was founded in 1867 to keep education running effectively. Many schools closed during the social changes occurring in the Civil War. George Peabody, however, raised funds for their development in the South. The Committee of Ten recommended that high school is oriented to prepare students for college, another key aspect that changed education forever. Since then, much has happened that has led to where we are today.
They say there's a place where dreams have all gone. They never said where, but I think I know. It's miles through the night, just over the dawn, on the road that will take me home.
My children had to go to a separate school for black students clear across town, no matter how far. And I resented that.
We just wanted things to be right, you know, to be like they should be.
Conclude that in the field of public education, the doctrine of separate but equal has no place.
I was in my senior high school in an English class, and on May 17, 1954, the gong sounded for the public address system, and the principal came on and said to us, Brown versus Board of Education has been decided, and in essence, the schools will be desegregated. My English teacher stood for a second with a tear in her eye, and she said, now I can retire.
We have built more schools in these last 7.5 years than we built in the previous 7.5, for that matter, in the previous 20 years. Let's take
hydroelectric. We also have an education crisis of the first degree. When I was a child, all our test scores were always going up, and we were all great kids. But then, somehow, in the late 70s and 80s and 90s, test scores started to not go up anymore and started to go down. And this is a huge, huge problem. Many, many young Americans don't know history, don't know geography, don't know anything except, I guess, how to get high. And education is a key element in forming human capital. If American young people, especially American young people who are not already rich, or at least upper middle class, are not going to acquire education, they're going to sink farther and farther down the income and wealth ladder, and the whole country is going to see a collapse in wealth and social mobility.
We've definitely hit some bumps along the way.
Rarely is the question asked, is our children learning? And find out that the literacy level of our children are appalling.
Teach a child to read, and he or her will be able to pass a literacy test.
Regardless of the flaws in the education system, education is ever-changing, ever-progressing. Technology is advancing. Teachers are being instilled with the ability to absorb the knowledge and skill to deal with and teach these changes. And most importantly, students are striving to better themselves by working to attend a facility that offers a higher education. The goal of bettering ourselves lies within education.